Hello students, welcome to getlectures.com, and in this video series I am going to explain NIELIT Computer Science 2016 paper. And this paper was held in 2016 for the post of Scientist B. Okay, so in this video series we will explain the question solution for the technical questions of this paper. And the question number one says, palindromes can't be recognized by a finite state automata, because what is the reason that a finite state machine cannot recognize palindrome string? Why is that so? So we know that palindrome string is like this. We can have even palindrome. Even palindrome language is like this. W and WR, in which first half is a string and the second half is the reverse of that string. So this is even palindrome. Okay, let's say string belongs to all the strings which can be formed by using AB. So this is a language which is accepting even palindrome. Okay, this cannot be accepted by a finite state machine. Finite state machine means DFA or NFA. This cannot be accepted by DFA and NFA. Why? Because to accept this language, you have to remember the first half of the language. Then you can recognize the second half of the language. Okay, so you have to remember the midpoint of the language. That's why, and finite state automata does not have any memory. Okay, to remember anything, you need a memory. But there is no memory in the finite state machine. Or we can have odd palindrome. Odd palindrome is like this. W, and we have center point, which will make this string odd. Okay, and W belongs to AB star. So none of these languages can be accepted by a finite state machine, because to accept this language, you have to remember the midpoint of the language. Okay, for example, strings would be like this. For even palindrome, strings will be like this. And if you want to see the odd palindrome, it will be like this. So this is odd palindrome and this is even palindrome, and this cannot be accepted by a finite state machine, because if you accept AB, then you have to remember the first part to accept BA. Okay, but finite state machine cannot remember anything. First reason is saying finite state automata cannot remember arbitrarily large amount of information. This is true. Okay, finite state automata cannot remember anything. Finite state automata cannot deterministically fix the midpoint. Okay, it cannot fix the midpoint, because to fix the midpoint, you have to remember the half of the string. Okay, first half of the string, then second half of the string should be equal to the first half of the string. Okay. C is saying, even if the midpoint is known, a finite state automata cannot find whether the second half of the string matches the first half. This is okay. But this can be done by a PDA. Okay. PDA can remember the first half of the string if we know the midpoint. So this is accepted by a PDA. Okay. Odd palindrome can be accepted by a deterministic pushdown automata, but cannot be accepted by a regular. This is not a regular language. Okay. Finite state machine can only recognize the regular language. But this is your DCFL. Odd palindrome is DCFL and even palindrome is CFL. So finite state automata cannot accept a palindrome string. So all of the above are the reasons that palindrome can't be recognized by a finite state machine. So all of the above are the reasons. So D is the answer for this question. Question number 62 says, process of analyzing relation schema to achieve minimal redundancy and insertion and updation anomalies is classified as which of the following? So what we mean by redundancy? Redundancy means same value is present in the multiple tables. For example, a phone number of a student can be in the student table, admin table, course table or fees table. All of these tables may have the same value, that is phone number. So if when you update the phone number in one table, you have to update this value in all the tables. Okay, this is redundancy. Sometimes redundancy is not desirable for a database. So when you update anything, you have to update it in all the tables. Okay, if you delete anything, you have to delete it from all the tables. So for that purpose, we use the normalization. Normalization is used to remove the redundancy plus to remove the anomalies due to removing of redundancy. So first problem is to remove the redundancy, plus there may be some problems after removing the redundancies. Okay, sometimes redundancy is useful and sometimes it is dangerous. So we have to deal with the problems when you remove the redundancy. So for that purpose, we use the normalization. In normalization, we normalize the tables according to some normal form. Okay, the best normal form which is desirable is BCNF. That is Boyce coordinate normal form. BCNF can remove all type of redundancies. So normalization of data need to be done to achieve the minimal redundancy and to deal with the insertion and updation anomalies. So A is the answer for this question. Question number 63 says, if L1 is CFL and L2 is regular language, then which of the following is false? Okay, so option A says L1 minus L2 is context free. Is it true or false? L1 minus L2 means L1 intersection L2 complement. Okay, or you can say this is CFL intersection and L2 is regular. We know that L2 is regular and the complement of regular language is also regular. Okay, the intersection of CFL intersection regular, okay, CFL intersection regular is always CFL. Okay, for example, let's say we have a CFL language, that is A to the power n and B to the power n. This is a CFL. Okay, this is a CFL. And let's say we have a language L2, that is, let's say, simple language AB star. This is regular language. So the intersection of these two languages will be A to the power n and B to the power n. This will be the intersection of these two. And this language is CFL. So intersection of a CFL language and a regular language is always a CFL. Okay, is always a CFL. And option A is saying L1 minus L2 is not context free, but it is context free. So definitely A is false. L1 intersection L2 is context free, that we have seen. Intersection of a L1 intersection L2 is context free. L1 is CFL and L2 is regular. It is given L1 is CFL and L2 is regular. So intersection of a CFL and regular is context free. This is true. Okay, this is true. The complement of a regular of a context free language. So context free language are not closed under the complement operation. So complement of a regular of a context free language is not context free language. May be CFL or may not be CFL. So it is not sure about the complement of a CFL, but DCFL is closed under the complement operation, but CFL is not closed under the complement operation. So this is false. The complement of a context free language is not a context free language. Okay, so C is false. So D is saying both A and C are false. So D is the right answer. We know that A and C are false. B is true. So answer to this question is D. We have a circuit. In this circuit, we have some NAND gates and we have to find the final output at Y. What is the combination of this complete circuit is representing? For example, this A is given to two inputs of this NAND gate. It will be A bar and this will be B bar. A bar, B bar is supplied to this NAND gate and it will become A bar into B bar. This is AND. And then we have to apply the NAND. Then this is given as an input to Y, which means A bar, B bar, complement, which was the input, and then complement, which is final output. So this can be written as A bar, B bar, or you can say A plus B whole bar. So this is nothing but this is NAND, this is NOR gate. Okay, this is NOR gate. A plus B is OR and the complement of OR is NOR gate. So answer to this question is B, that is NOR gate. Question number 65. Let G be a simple undirected planar graph on 10 vertices. In this we have 10 vertices with 15 edges. So we have 15 edges in this graph and this graph is connected. Undirected planar graph. Okay. If G is connected, G is a connected graph, okay, this is given that G is a connected graph, then the number of bounded faces in any embedding of G on the plane is equal to What is the number of bounded faces? We have to find the number of bounded faces. Okay, this graph is connected. So for connected graph, we have component one. Okay, we have only one component in this graph because this is connected. So number of regions is given by E minus N plus one. These are the bounded regions in a graph. Okay, bounded regions. If question asks number of total regions are bounded regions plus one, because we have one unbounded region in every graph. So that will be R equals to E minus N plus two. Okay, total number of regions, or you can say bounded plus unbounded regions. So in every graph, we have bounded regions and unbounded regions. So bounded regions are one less than, because one region is unbounded, but question is asking only about the bounded regions, bounded faces. So this will be E minus N plus one. So number of regions will be E is 15 given, and is given 10 plus one, that is six. So we have total six faces or six regions in this graph. So answer to this question is D. Question number 66 says, which of the following is wrong? So we are talking about the Turing machine. A is saying Turing machine is a simple mathematical model of general purpose computer. B is saying Turing machine is more powerful than finite automata. Turing machine can be simulated by a general purpose computer. So let's look at the options one by one. What is Turing machine? Let's see. What is Turing machine? Theoretically, Turing machine is given by Alan Turing in 1936. Okay, so a Turing machine is abstract or hypothetical machine which is thought by a mathematician, that is Alan Turing, in 1936, which is capable of simulating any algorithm. We can simulate any algorithm using the Turing machine. Okay, so it is given by Alan Turing. The Turing machine is, we have an infinite tape in the Turing machine, which means we have infinite memory in a Turing machine. So definitely Turing machine cannot be simulated by a general purpose computer, because we have limited memory in general purpose computer, for example 4 GB RAM or 8 GB RAM. So we have a limited memory in general purpose computer, but Turing machine says it has infinite tape. Okay, this means Alan Turing machine can be used to simulate any algorithm. Okay, but we cannot simulate Turing machine using the general purpose computer, because in Turing machine we have infinite tape, but in general purpose computers we have only finite tape, we have finite memory. So option C is false. Turing machine can be simulated by a general purpose computer. No, Turing machine cannot be simulated by a general purpose computer. So B is saying Turing machine is more powerful than finite automata. This is true. Okay, Turing machine is more powerful than finite automata, because finite automata does not have any memory, but Turing machine has infinite tape, it has memory. So it is capable of doing more powerful operations than finite automata. So Turing machine is more powerful than finite automata. Actually, Turing machine is theoretical model of a computer, or you can say abstract model of a computer, or you can say mathematical model of a computer. So A is saying Turing machine is a simple mathematical model of a general purpose computer. This is true. Turing machine is actually a mathematical model, or you can say abstract model or hypothetical model of a computer. So we are talking about the wrong. So C is wrong. Turing machine can be simulated by a general purpose computer. No, Turing machine cannot be simulated by a general purpose computer. So C is the answer for this question. Question number 68. What will be the output of the output if you will compile and execute the following code? We have to find the output of this code. Only trick in this code is that we are printing C with percent D. Okay, C is 125 and C equals to C plus 10, printf percent D. So in memory, C will be stored like this. C will occupy one byte because this is character. So we will represent 125 like this. So 125 is 0111101. This is 125. Okay, in binary. So this will be stored like this in the computer. This is 125. Now what we are doing is we are updating C by adding 10 to this. So this will be updated like this. When we add 10 to this, 10 is 1010. This is 10. So add these two numbers, 1 1 1, 0, then 0, 1 plus 1 is 0, 1 plus 1 is 0 and 1. So this will be 1, 4 times 0 and 111. This will be the final value of C after adding 10. Now we are trying to print C by using the percent %d. What will happen is, computer will look at this, computer will think that because we represent the numbers in computer using the 2's complement. Okay, using the 2's complement. We represent any number in computers using 2's complement. So, and the, as you can see, first bit of the number is 1. So this is definitely a negative number. So we have to find the 2's complement of this number. Then we will print this value. So we have 1000. 0111 and the simple, this is 2's complement. If I want to find the binary equivalent of this 2's complement, it will be minus 1, that is 1, 4 times 0, 110. Now we have to complement this. Complement means 0, 4 times 1, 001. Okay, so this is nothing but 1. 248 plus 16 plus 32 plus 64, that is 64 plus 32 plus 16 plus 8 plus 1, that is 9 plus 6 15 and 2 17 plus 4 21, then 3 plus 3 6 and 6 12. So this is nothing but negative 121. Okay, this will be printed as minus 121. We are assuming that because printf %d will actually access 2 bytes. %d is used to print the integer value of any character here. So it will access 2 bytes. We are assuming that first byte is 0. Okay, first byte is 0, then this will print minus 121. Because the number is negative, this should be converted into 2's complement to find the exact value. Because the exact value was stored in the memory using the 2's complement. So we have to reverse the process to find the exact value which we actually stored the inside the memory. So answer for this question will be minus 121. We can see by running this program. And this is the same program in the question, that is int main char c equals to 125, c equals to c plus 10, and I'm printing c using the %d. So if I run this program, the output will be minus 121. Okay, minus 121 will be the answer for this question. Next question is 69. The first network was, okay, first network was ARPANET. So A is the right answer for this question. Question number 72. The running time of quickshot algorithm depends heavily on the selection of what? So in quickshot, we have an element that is called pivot element, and according to pivot element, we partition the array. Okay, this is the simple, this is the basic difference between quickshot and merge sort. In merge sort, we blindly divide the array in two parts, but in quickshot, we divide the array according to the pivot element. Okay, so on the left hand side, all the elements to pivot are less than the, all the elements on the left hand side are less than the pivot element on, and all the elements to the right of the pivot element are greater than the pivot element. So division definitely depends on the quickshot. The running time of quickshot definitely depends on the pivot element. If we select the pivot element, for example, if we have only one element to the left of a pivot element and n minus element to the right of the element, that it will give the worst case complexity. It will give order of n square. Okay, if we have balanced pivot, that is pivot is always in the middle element. Okay, then quickshot will give that is average case complexity, that is order of log n. So the complexity of quickshot algorithm depends on the pivot element, that is d. Question number 73. What will be the output of if you will compile and execute the following C code? So we have three line code, that is void main printf %d size of 5.2. Okay, this is a, as you can see, this is float value. And we have not declared any variable for this value. The size of this variable will be 8 bytes because this value will be represented in the computer using the double precision format. Okay, that is using the double format. And double takes 8 bytes. Okay, this will be represented in the memory using the double precision format, that is 8 byte. And we can see this program by running onto a compiler. So if I run this program using the DevC compiler, it will give the output as 8. Okay, the output of this program will be 8. The size of 5.2 will be 8 because this number will be represented in the memory using the 8 bytes, that is double precision format or 8 byte format, because this will be represented as double, not float. Okay, so the answer to this question is 8 bytes. Question number 74. This question says, the identification of common sub-expression and replacement of runtime computation by compile-time computation is known as which of the optimization? Local optimization, constant folding, loop optimization, or data flow analysis? Okay, so we have optimization. We have two kind of optimization in compiler design. Okay, code optimization, we can optimize the code using two approaches. First is loop optimization, and in loop optimization we can optimize the loop in many ways. First is frequency reduction. Second is loop unrolling. Third is loop jamming. And second kind of code optimization can be folding. Okay, or you can say constant folding. So in frequency reduction, what we do is we actually place the high frequency operation outside the loop. For example, in frequency reduction, for example, I have a code that is while I greater than I less than 500, and I have an operation inside this loop that is sine x divided by cos x into I and I minus minus. So I have this operation. What I can do is, because sine x and cos x are not changing anywhere, what I can do is, this is expansive operation, and I can keep this operation outside loop, because this operation sine x by cos x will be evaluated every time in every iteration of the loop. So this will be done 500 times. So what I can do is, I can keep this operation outside the loop. How? Let's say I can calculate value of sine x by cos x once in a variable t, and then I can run the loop like this while I less than 500, and simply I can replace sin x by cos x by t. Okay, which means the expression will become like this, 2 into I and I minus minus. So what I have done is, I have replaced this expensive calculation. I have kept this expensive calculation outside the loop. This is known as frequency reduction. In loop unrolling, what we do is, we try to replace a single operation with the multiple operation to actually reduce the number of iteration in a loop. For example, if I have a loop like this, while I less than 10, then initialize all the elements of array by 0. Okay, I am doing this operation. What I can do is, in every iteration I am initializing only one variable. I can replace this with some expression, like I can actually initialize two elements of array in a single iteration of the loop. So loop will run only 5 times when I actually replace this value by like this, xi equals to 0, I plus plus, then this I has become 1, so now x1 will be, xi will be 0, and I plus plus. So what I have done is, I have actually initialized two array elements in the one iteration. Like this, I will increase twice in each iteration, and I will reach the value 10 only in 5 iterations. In this case, I is reaching to 10 in 10 iterations. So I have reduced the number of iterations in the loop by doing this simple modification. So this is known as loop unrolling. Loop jamming means I am combining two loops in single loop. Okay, if these two loops which I am actually combining in one loop should be independent of each other and should have the index same. So this is the condition for loop jamming. In constant folding, what we do is, in constant folding, we replace the runtime operations by the compile time. For example, if we have something like this, if I have an operation like this, d equals to 2 plus 3 plus c plus b. Okay, this operation is actually happening. This expression will be calculated at the runtime. What I can do is, I know that 2 plus 3 is 5. So I can simply calculate this value at the compile time. Compile time means during the programming. So I can write like this, 5 plus c plus b. So this constants is being folded to one value. So this is known as constant folding, because now this on this calculation will be ignored. 2 plus 3, I do not need to do this operation at the runtime, because I have calculated this at the compile time. This calculation will be done at the runtime. So I have replaced a runtime calculation with the compile time calculation. The question is saying the identification of common sub expression and replacement of runtime computation by compile time computation is known as constant folding. So B is the right answer for this question. Question number 75. Which of the following need not be a binary tree? Okay, which of the following is not necessarily a binary tree? So search tree are like binary search trees or B plus trees. These are search trees. So definitely they are binary trees. Heaps is not necessarily a binary tree. Heap can be Fibonacci heap or binary heap, or it can be binomial heap. Okay, binomial heap and Fibonacci heap are not binary trees. We can have more than one nodes in Fibonacci heap or in binomial heaps. So they are not binary trees. AVL tree is definitely a binary tree, which is actually a balanced binary search tree. B tree is simply binary tree. So all these three are the binary trees, but heap does not need to be a binary tree. It can be triary tree, or it can have four childrens. Okay, in case of Fibonacci heap or binomial heap. So heap is not necessarily a binary tree. B is the right answer for this question. Question number 76. Two main measures for the efficiency of an algorithm are. So how we find the efficiency of an algorithm? How we compare two algorithms? We compare two algorithms on the basis of time complexity and space complexity. Time complexity and space complexity are two measures to actually measure the efficiency of an algorithm. A is saying process and memory. No, processor and memory is the part of hardware. We cannot measure the efficiency of an algorithm using these components, complexity and capacity. Time and space, yes, we can measure the complexity efficiency of an algorithm in using the time complexity and space complexity. So C is the right answer for this question. Question number 78. Which of the following is not defined in a good software requirement specification in any SRS document? Which of the following is not defined? In SRS document, we define every kind of requirement, okay, which are required by the client and which are actually required by the developers. So all the requirements are documented in a single document, that is SRS document. We only document the SRS, we only document the requirements in an SRS document. We do not include any implementation detail in a SRS document. So functional requirements are definitely specified in SRS document. Goal of implementations are specified in SRS document. Non-functional requirements are also included in SRS document. But the algorithm for software development is not included in the SRS document. This is actually included in the design document. Okay, so algorithm for software implementation is not specified in the SRS document. So D is the right answer for this question. Question number 79. Communication between a computer and a keyboard involves what kind of transmission? We know that between a computer and a keyboard, there is only one transmission. Keyboard is an input device which is giving input to the CPU. Okay, so keyboard is giving the input to CPU. So data transfer is only one way. So when we say, let's say I have a CPU and there is a keyboard. So data will always flow in one direction, that is keyboard to CPU. So CPU to keyboard is not, we cannot send the data from CPU to keyboard, because this is an input device. We are taking the input from the keyboard. Keyboard has nothing to store, nothing. Keyboard cannot store anything, or keyboard cannot show anything. CPU will never send any detail to keyboard. And in same way, CPU will send something to the output device. So CPU cannot take an input from the output device. It can only show the output to output device. CPU will send something to output device. So all input devices and output devices are half duplex. Half duplex means data can flow only in one direction, and it can flow only in one direction. Simplex means data can flow only in one direction. Half duplex means data can flow in both direction, but only at a time, only data will be flowed only in one direction. Okay, for example, radios are the half duplex. Okay, or we talk about the walkie talkies, they are half duplex. Simplex means, for example, your television, only television is showing you something. You cannot send some signal to the TV. Okay, only TV can show you something. So TV, the transmission in TV is simplex. In walkie-talkie, they are half duplex. Full duplex means you are full duplex is the example of phone call. In phone call, you can send the data to receiver and can receive the data, okay, at the same time, which means there can be a full duplex communication in the phone call. At the same time, sender and receiver can send the data, and data can flow in both directions. In half duplex, data can flow in both directions, but only at one direction at a time. In simplex means data can flow only in one direction, either sender to receiver or receiver to sender. So this type of combination is simplex. Okay, this is simplex communication. Question number 80. Bluetooth is an example of which of the following networks? Bluetooth is a short-range device and it can only be used for a personal area network. Okay, we can only arrange a personal area network using the Bluetooth. Question number 82 says the structure or format of data is called what? Syntax, struct, or semantic? Semantic means the meaning of the data structure. Okay, struct means the restrictions or the rules inside a data type. For example, in integer data type, we have some rules that we can have only integer values inside an integer and the range is specified. For example, for -32767 to 32768. So these are the part of a structure of a data type. So this is saying the structure or format of data type is called structure. For example, we have a structure for defining a float. Float value can only be defined like this, or it can only be defined like this if you are initializing a value. So this is the syntax of a data type. Okay, this is talking about the structure or format. This is a format of a data type, or you can say data. F is data, and the structure of data is like this. So definitely, this is talking about the syntax. Question number 83. A non-pipeline system with 50 nanosecond to process a task. The same task can be processed in a 6-segment pipeline with a clock cycle of 10 nanosecond. Determine the speed up ratio of the pipeline for 100 tasks. So we have two approaches. Okay, we have two options to execute the instructions using the non-pipelining or using the pipelining. So we have to find out the time taken in non-pipeline and pipeline. Time taken in non-pipeline is simple, number of instructions into time taken by each instruction. In case of non-pipeline, time taken in pipeline is k number of stages plus n minus 1 into time taken by stage. Okay, so this is the formula for pipeline, this is the formula for non-pipeline. So cycle is given that cycle time is given 50 nanosecond and number of instructions are 100. So in case of non-pipeline, it will take 50 into 100, that is number of tasks into time taken by each task, that is 500,000 nanosecond. Time taken in non-pipeline. In case of pipeline, it will take k is given 6. Okay, this is 6-stage pipeline. So in case of pipeline, it will be 6 plus n is 100 minus 1, and time taken by each task is TP is 50 nanosecond, and this will be 105 into 50. That is okay. Time is given in case of in case of pipeline, it is given 10 nanosecond. Okay, in case of non-pipeline, it is given 50 nanosecond. So TP is 10 nanosecond, and time taken in non-pipeline is 50 nanoseconds. So we have to multiply by 10 nanoseconds, not 50. So this will be 1050 nanoseconds. Speed up is nothing but time taken in non-pipeline divided by time taken in pipeline. So time taken in non-pipeline is 5000 nanoseconds, and time taken in case of pipeline is 1050 nanosecond. This is nothing but 4.76. This is the speed up in this scenario. Then this is asking, we can directly mark the option B by using this. What is the determine the speed up ratio, and we have to find the what is the maximum speed up. Maximum speed up in a pipeline can be equals to number of stages. Okay, S max is number of stages, that is 6. Okay, so we do not have any option with 6, so option B is correct. So maximum pipeline we will assume is 5. Question number 84 says, given two DFAs M1 and M2, we have two DFAs, they are equivalent. How we can find that they are equivalent? We can, two DFAs are equivalent only if the language accepted by M1 machine is equal to language accepted by M2. Okay, this is the only condition in which we can say two DFAs are equal. A's option is saying M1 and N2 has the same number of states. Okay, we can have more, we can have same number of states in multiple languages. Okay, so on the basis of this, the same number of states, we cannot say that two DFAs are equal. B is saying if M1 and M2 accept the same language, definitely for every DFA, for every language, we will have a single minimized DFA. Okay, for every language, there is a single DFA. There is a unique DFA. So this is true. M1 and N2 has the same number of final states. We cannot say two DFAs are equal on the basis of number of final states. Okay, so B is the right answer. If two DFAs accept the same language, then they are equal. Question number 87 says, what is the solution to the recurrence relation Tn equals to Tn by 2 plus n? Okay, so we have a recurrence relation Tn equals to Tn by 2 plus n. So this can be simply solved by using the recurrence relation, using the Master's theorem. And in Master's theorem, your recurrence relation should be in the form of Atn by b plus fn. In this case, as we can see, a is 1, b is 2, fn is n. First, what we do is we find the k equals to log ba. Then we compare n to the power k with the fn. Okay, then we apply the cases according to the comparison. So a equals to 1, b equals to 2, fn equals to n. So log ba will be, k equals to log ba will be log 2 1, or you can say log 2 2 to the power 0 or equals to 0. So the value of k is 0. Now you have to find the value of n to the power k. N to the power k is n to the power 0, that is 1. So if you compare 1 and fn, that is n, fn is n. So definitely n is greater than 1. So the time complexity of this will be order of n according to Master's theorem. So answer is B for this question. Question number 88, which one of the following is not necessarily a property of a group? So group, for any relation to be, for anything to be a group, we have some properties. First property is it should follow the closure property. Okay, relation should be closed. Okay, operation should be closed. Second, it should have an identity element. And for any for every element, we should have an inverse. And the operations inside this should be associative. These are the four conditions to be a group. Okay. If you add one more property to this, that is commutativity, then this becomes abelian group. The group becomes abelian group. Okay, so these four are the properties for a group. This is asking about the group. Which of the following is not a property for a group? Associativity is a property of group. Existence of inverse for every element. Existence of identity. Commutativity is not a condition for a group. Commutativity is a condition for being an abelian group. So A is the right answer for this question.